parties out into the western reaches of the colony of Virginia, and they determined that the rise of the Potomac was in Tarrant County. So, did two things. First of all, this is when settlement here really gets in gear, really starts to swing. And second, it introduced to us probably the most influential man who set foot in the Shenandoah Valley in the 18th century. Because this is all virgin land, you had to have a surveyor. And there was a young lad, first named George, in 1748, who was making a living being a surveyor, working for Lord Fairfax. And George Washington came here, walked the land, liked it, bought it, encouraged older half-brother Lawrence to buy it. And this begins his knowledge of and interest in the Shenandoah Valley. And what he does during his lifetime, especially during his presidency, has major impact on what happens here in Jefferson County. It's all about the rivers, Jim.
I've heard that somewhere before.
Now, as soon as settlement really starts, more people coming in, it's okay, Pat, to wade across the river if you're just in a horse. But if you're going to bring your wagon full of stuff, you got to make it a little easier. And that's what starts happening in the 1750s. The Potomac is a major entry point for most people coming into the valley. There are those who estimate that of the settlement before the Revolutionary War, 80% of it came into the valley from the north, from the Penn Colony across Route 30 to York, and then into the valley. So to make these conveyances easier, several men requested and received permission to begin establishing ferries. 1755, and that lines up with our early settlement. And notice the king is George II. This is still the Virginia colony. Public ferries constantly kept, and the first one in our area that's approved by the colony is near present-day Shepherdstown and is owned by the Swearingen family. There is who rode with Sadler and Starry in the wagon that took John Brown to the execution site. There are probably a million people that say, I did. And the same thing applies to the exact location of Thomas Swearingen's first ferry. Okay? The only thing we know for sure, it was in the County Frederick, because at this point, Jefferson County was still part of Frederick County, Virginia. Over the river to his land opposite in the province of Maryland. So, if you can envision present-day Shepherdstown, somewhere in the vicinity of the bridge that crosses over the Potomac River from Shepherdstown to Sharpsburg, somewhere in that vicinity, below Bellevue, where Gay Shepherd lives today, somewhere in that vicinity. Now, we'll tighten it down at some point, but that's where this whole thing started. March 1761, 6 years later, public ferries again encouraged because we're getting even more settlement, this time from the land of Robert Harper at the confluence of the Potomac and Shenandoah Rivers, established as, and the interesting thing is, you know, in these enactments, they also included what you charge for a wagon, how much if you're walking on foot, if you're driving livestock. So this was not only a convenience, it was also a business. And the Swearingen family and the Harper family both profited from that.
Did the families that owned the land lose it through like eminent domain, or did they run the ferries?
They ran from their ferry across, from their land across the river.
So they were appointed by the king to be a ferry operator.
Absolutely. And we'll see in just a second how tight it is. So, by the 1760s, there are two conveyances across the Potomac River. The Shenandoah will be late. Now, you can see, and again, this is from the Pride Jefferson map. Look at the roads. Here's the wagon road. And that becomes what is today Route 11 or Route 81. Okay? If you ever have the opportunity, look at a satellite image of Pennsylvania, Maryland, and Virginia, West Virginia. And look at the terrain. And you see a perfect upside-down question mark that leads from Philadelphia into the Valley of the Shenandoah. And that's the route they took. That was the Great Valley. It was the path of least resistance. So everything came from Philadelphia and bent through that to York, following Route 30, eventually a little branch, because it was well known and well established that below present-day Shepherdstown, there was a river crossing. And it's had a thousand names. Packhorse Ford, Blackford's Ford, Boatler's Ford. Sometimes so many names it was confusing. It was confusing on the day of September the 20th, 1862, when two armies sent opposing forces to defend a site that wasn't listed. Jackson told his guys to go to Boatler's Ford. Well, his men were unfamiliar with Boatler's Ford. They didn't know what that was. But these roads, our first roads, come across first those easy fords, because there's an easy ford here across the river, which is roughly present-day Route 9. And that was a road that went from Alexandria, Virginia, all the way to Berkeley Springs. Berkeley Springs at the time was bad, and people were going there to take the waters. So the Warm Springs Road, and you could drive on a piece of that between Carneysville behind T.A. Lowry School, the Warm Springs Road, and the road from Packhorse Ford up Trough Road, for those of you who know Shepherdstown, up Trough Road, and they were all working their way to the county seat of Winchester. Because you got to do business. And Winchester was the county seat, and that's where these roads were trying to find their way, all trying to go in that direction. But now, we're going to make this conveyance easy, because by mid-1760s, we've got not one but two ferries. One at Shepherdstown, one at Harper's Ferry. So, this is where early settlement starts. You know, some people are just tickled to death to get across the Potomac River, buy a piece of land from Lord Fairfax, and start going to work. And the evidence of that is, by the 1780s, there are already working mills in this part of then Berkeley County in the 1780s. You know, Robert Harper wouldn't have done it. First thing he did after he finished building mills in Winchester was to build mills at Harper's Ferry. And the first mill was a sawmill. He knew sawing trees up, make lumber for houses. What was Thomas Shepard's first move? Town run. Put a grist mill in there. So the story is tied to this early settlement, but you can't overlook the influence that the Potomac and Shenandoah Rivers had on these settlements. That's what brought people here. Uh-oh. 1765, King George III, our favorite. Be it enacted that a ferry be established and constantly kept in the land of Thomas Shepard. Now, Thomas Shepard, unless I'm wrong, settled somewhere near present-day Shepherdstown. And there was already something going on at the bottom of the hill there, run by the Swearingen family. So a year later, George straightened it out. An act passed in the fifth year of the present Majesty's reign, a ferry appointed land Thomas Shepard, the same being at a very small distance from. Shepherd was running his ferry from the bottom of present-day Princess Street. So there's a little hint at where Swearingen's ferry was, somewhere in the near vicinity. And it was so close that Shepherd's right to run a ferry was rescinded, and the operation of the ferry continued in the Swearingen family. So, first of all, it tells you that the General Assembly is aware of the fact that they're providing duplicitous service. You know, there's no point if you've got a successful operation going, there's no point in putting somebody there because this is government appointed. Now, if it was commercial, private, but that wasn't the case then. The other thing it tells us that somewhere near where Thomas Shepherd wanted to start his ferry, Swearingen already had his in place. So, the Swearingens continued from 1755 until 1849, one way or the other, to operate a ferry, which will eventually be located precisely at the foot of Princess Street. Now, the Swearingen surname is out of the business in the early 1800s. A Swearingen daughter marries into the Blackford family. And the Blackfords are at the top of the hill on the Maryland side. That's Blackford's Hill, it became Blackford's Ford one time. Both Blackfords are out of the picture, and one of their sons in 1849 will sell the property to a bridge company, and that's when the bridge comes into play at Shepherdstown. This is the same family. You know, the building's still there, Ferry Hill, top of the hill, built by the Blackford family. Young daughter Elizabeth married a widower preacher from Shepherdstown, last name Douglas. This is where Henry Kidd Douglas grew up, the top of the hill there. His dad was a former preacher in Shepherdstown and married into the Blackford family, and they are operating Ferry Hill at the time of the Civil War. Now, told you I'd tell you, and this is Bard. Where's Eleanor? This is from the Historic Shepherdstown Commission. And this is probably the first plat for the new village of Shepherdstown. A couple things are key. First of all, Mecklenburg in all the books is spelled M-E-C-K-L-E-N-B-U-R-G. This is B-U-R-G-H, Mecklenburg. The other thing, I know it's so hard to see, but this is present day, this is the north end of town, present day Rocky Street, what's left of it. On this map, it was called Market Street. Everything else is legit. The lot numbers all line up, but there's some cool stuff you can see when you look. There's how it's built. Now this is a clip, okay? And Oriental, okay? That's Mill Street. And that's the north end of Mill Street. The north end of Princess Street. And Princess Street is the street that goes down the hill past the tobacco bar, tobacco warehouse. Then there's a legend. Here's the river, Old Potomac River, right at the bottom of the hill. And the legend says, road to the ferry. Okay. And ferry landing. So, by the 1780s, Swearingen's ferry had lined itself up with the bottom of Princess Street. And this is where they passed back and forth across the Potomac River from Virginia into Maryland. Okay? Now, the other thing to be aware of, those of you familiar with Shepherdstown, okay, Princess Street although on the map it's straight, in application it's not. And we'll see a photograph that very clearly displays that it took a dog leg to go over closer the run. Now, the Blackford family sold their interest in the ferry landing to the Virginia and Maryland Bridge Company. No one thing, Andrew from Maryland, Gene, if you read this story in Maryland, it will say the Maryland and Virginia. But since we're on the other side of the river, we're going to say Virginia and Maryland. And I stole this from our copy of the S. Hal Brown map, 1852, which is right next to Sarah back there. So this is a woodcut that was part of the map that S. Hal Brown made in 1852, and shows you a view looking roughly from the top of the hill, the Ferry Hill, looking south into Shepherdstown. And you can see, look at this dog leg. This is Princess Street. Coming down, and had to make a hook to get up on the bridge. And this bridge will be a toll bridge well into the 1930s. You paid a toll to go across the bridge until the state of West Virginia took it over in the 1930s. Now, Swearingen's Ferry. I could not find a question mark, so I had to put a star. But just pretend that that's a question. Because somewhere in this vicinity, slightly upriver here, is the Swearingen home Bellevue. But exactly where, I don't know. All we know for sure, by the time it's called Blackford's Ferry, the ferry site is here at the bottom of then Princess Street, right at the bottom of the street. And the ferry operated back and forth across the river. And if you've ever seen the movie The Outlaw Josie Wales, with the rope that's strung from one shore to the other, and you use the pull rope to pull the ferry across the river, same convenience. Now that'll change in the 20th century, but at that point it was a rope pull. Purchased 1849 from the Blackford family, but for $15,000. And the Billmeyer family became principally involved in the management of this bridge into the 20th century. David Billmeyer will actually be responsible for rebuilding it. We'll see in just a second. And this was very similar, and I've never been able to determine. Now, I think maybe the same bridge company that did our bridge at Harper's Ferry did this bridge at Shepherdstown, because they sure do look a lot alike. They sure do look a lot alike. But just woodcuts. Now, there is existent in the Historic Shepherdstown Commission collection a picture, because we're going to see what happened to this bridge in the Civil War. There's an 1870 photograph of that bridge, but that, nothing before. Always been a kind of a mystery. And here's two lanes, no train, but two lanes, so you can have north, south.